than even when he was born, and he was. He didn't have SMA, but even when he was born, I immediately went into panic and was just struck by the beast of postpartum anxiety and trauma, which I know now it was trauma, but all that trauma and pain was just reactivated with his birth. And I just had a total breakdown and did not know what was going on. Started having, you know, panic attacks and all these things that I'd never had. So I really beat myself up, because I'm like, you took care of a daughter that was medically fragile for 3 years. And like, what are you doing? You have you have two healthy baby boys.
Yeah.
Like, what is your problem? Stop falling apart. And I was just so unkind to myself and thought, you know, I want to move on. I don't want to be in this pain anymore. And I'm okay. I've stopped crying every day. So why does this feel so hard and tender and painful? And why am I so afraid that he's going to die and that I'm going to die? I was just so overwhelmed with, you know, I just had no idea what was going on. So that was intensely painful and scary. And
that experience with your second son, what's his name?
Rory.
Sorry, I forgot. That experience with Rory, then how old was he when, was it straight away that you developed postpartum depression and anxiety? Okay. And mm-hmm. So how did you even know in that time, sort of how to, did you know, I should ask you this first. Did you know straight away to access help? Was your husband saying you need help? What was the thing, you know, or was it just, I can't function. And so you didn't have the choice.
It was, I can't function, but, and there's something wrong with me, but I don't want to know what it is, but I need to find out what it is.
Wow.
Yeah. But it's not just anxiety. It's, I have a heart problem, or I have a breathing problem, or it was all of that medical anxiety just coming in and just crushing me. And of course, when you have a newborn, you're very vulnerable, and in the postpartum alone with the hormones,
absolutely.
I mean, women can be at risk for postpartum anxiety and depression with no history of trauma. Mm-hmm. So it was sort of a double whammy for me, because it was postpartum stuff, but it was just a lot of unresolved pain and trauma I hadn't dealt with. And frankly, I don't think I could have dealt with it at the time or before. I mean, we got pregnant with Rory a year or so after she passed. I just sort of was so afraid. I couldn't really imagine it passing. I couldn't imagine it all being in my, like a mental thing, like a mental anguish. Surely there's something wrong with my body because of the way it's reacting.
Mm-hmm.
So it took a long time to come to terms with it. Like 9 months postpartum that I was like, I need help.
Oh, that's a long time.
My body's. Yeah.
Yeah. I think that we were just talking about this the other day, my husband and I, that, you know, even that term mental health, for so many of us, we think of like, thoughts, not brain,
mm-hmm.
you know? Mm-hmm. And so we think of like, if we can just control our thoughts, we'll be fine.
Oh my gosh.
But this is not, it's not thought health, it's brain health. And
preach it. It is so true. It is so true. Yeah. And I literally just learned that like a couple weeks ago, because I have since had another baby, and it's a little girl, Odessa.
And she's gorgeous. Of your kids are gorgeous. Your family is just spectacular.
Thank
Precious.
You.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it, you know, I have recently started trauma therapy, like specifically, you know, not just reproductive mental health, because a lot of that too, even the postpartum anxiety, I'm like, I'm not worried about, like, I don't know where I fit into this, you know, like, this isn't just in my head and I'm not having these intrusive thoughts, and, but I feel these things, and I did just have a baby, and this was all triggered by me having a baby. And, yeah, my trauma therapist has just been so affirming, and, you know, I'll just start bawling. 'Cause I'm like, she's like, this, of course your body's going to do that. Or she'll see the way I move my eyes, or just so many little things that she can read in my body. And then she can explain it, and like, this is what happens, and like your brainstem, and this is where the trauma is stored. And it just, it's all like clicking into place, you know, like I am not overthinking, or yeah, it's not my thoughts. Like, let's try, you know, cognitive behavioral therapy on what, like, it's trauma. It's all coming at me. You know, I'm not sitting here like, I hate my life. And like, it's just been such a confusing journey, because it's just, I haven't known where to find the help, you know, and then a lot of therapists, and especially when you have a baby, it's like, yeah, it's considered just strictly postpartum mental health. And I think there's a lot of guilt placed on moms, like, especially if they have lost a child or a spouse or a parent. And there's these triggers that happen in our body, and, you know, it's not just our thoughts that are causing them, and anxiety can absolutely do that. And there's so many different ways the body can respond, but a lot of it is just this unprocessed trauma, and the body's screaming and trying to tell us, like, I need to get this out. I need to heal. But it's really hard to make space, because society is so fast paced, and, you know, you go, I had a baby and I love this, and I want to be present in this. Like, I don't want to dig into the work.
Yeah.
Like, this is not the time.
Well, and you were not a person, you have not been a person who's ever shied away from grief. I mean, I think that's why, you know, those who are maybe just now being introduced to you, Michaela writes openly and has for many, many years about grief and about, you know, what that means. And so it's not as if you're a person that's just shut it all inside. So how do you reconcile that when you can kind of look back and go, look, I thought I was doing the work, or I thought I was processing this. I was naming this as grief. I was naming this tragedy. I was naming this suffering. And yet, you know, now this trauma is coming out in physical ways that you didn't even realize your body was carrying. How do you reconcile that? You've not put your grief in the closet, like perhaps some of us do as a coping mechanism. You haven't done that, and yet you still are having to deal with trauma in ways that that you, I imagine, never
require lots of work. Yeah, I honestly, I've thought that many times, and I thought, you know, haven't I done the work? Like, isn't talking and writing about grief and pain a part of the process? And I'm not afraid of the process or the pain. But I think, you know, I've learned a lot in the last month, but I do know that the first sort of step in processing trauma is talking about it, and talk therapy, and that usually just doesn't do the job. Like, there requires more work. So even just going to a counselor and talking about the loss, the pain, might not be enough. And I think that's actually probably pretty common. And so I think I just thought, you know, I'm just gonna, express myself and express my heart and hope to help others in their grief and in their pain. But what I didn't really, I think, come to terms with was, yeah, I'm a grief-stricken mother. I've been through pain, but I'm a traumatized. I've been traumatized. Mm. No, like people have seen and felt worse. And that feels like an over here sort of those people are traumatized, not me. I've experienced trauma, but it takes, for me, it took a lot of effort and work and courage to say, like, my body and my brain have been traumatized. And, you know, any book on trauma is going to tell you that, like, if you're in extended fight or flight for 3 years, like, your body just starts to rewire itself. And it also, I've talked to people recently who are like, I don't have the same sort of trauma as you. And I'm like, I'm just going to stop you right there, because trauma is trauma. You know, pain can feel differently for people. And of course, like, some pain, you know, people don't compare your pain to mine if you lost your dog or you know, or even your mom. It's different than losing your kid. You know, there are different levels of grief and how it affects you and how it can affect your mental health and how it can affect your body. So for me, as a childbearing woman, like, I continued to have traumas because I kept having more babies, because I was just holding that fear and like the what if, and any mother who's had a baby and lost the baby, who's had a child with a medical complication, who's lost an older child, and they want to go have more babies, it is, you could write a book on that alone.
Yeah.
The pain and the fear and the anxiety and the faith and the hope and the loss of hope. And, you know, because as you know, like, you can have all the hope in the world and still have a devastating outcome. And so I knew that. I was like, I know anything could go wrong in my pregnancies. Just because I've had this terrible diagnosis, or just because I've lost my daughter, doesn't mean I won't have a stillborn child, or this baby won't have some other complication, or I won't have a, like, I knew just the reality of living in this world. It's just knowing that we can have these big little T traumas, you know.
Yeah.
And when they start to just stack up onto each other, we are given more than we can handle, and our bodies are wonderful, and they try to cope, and then that's just what happens, is things develop, anxiety or depression or so many things, and it's the brain is just trying to grapple with the pain, and we're, you know, pushing it away, or we're trying to move on, or we're not wanting to dig in, or we, like, for me, I am trying to dig in, but, you know, there's blockages. Me, a lot of it was around my faith and spirituality, of like learning to trust God again and wholeheartedly, and not just with my past pain, but in the moment, like, here I am again with this postpartum anxiety and all of these similar feelings, and my body's just going right into that same mode. And I just fought with my body, like, why are you doing this? Like, why are you facing, like, why are you feeling these sensations or these feelings? Like, you're just at the park with your kids. It's okay. You have a baby girl. You have another girl. And same talk, you know. And finally, yeah, my therapist was like, you need to, your body has experienced this too, and you need to love her and accept her for what's happening to her. And instead of having my body be, you know, maybe something that's betrayed me because it, you know, I carried Florence in my womb and something happened, and not that it was my fault, but, you know, as a mom, and when you're creating babies in your womb, like, there's just all sorts of things that you take on and you try to make sense of, and we're very often just not aware of what we're believing about ourselves or about God or about, you know, just, it's really messy. So I just dove head first into it. I'm like, I need to figure this out. This is not just postpartum anxiety.
And it's the kindness of God, isn't it? As you start to learn to pay attention to your body, that it's actually his, mm-hmm. one of his ways of helping signal to us, there's a problem here. And I'm not just trying, like, I'm not just punishing you, but it's actually a gift. Our pain mm-hmm. in that way becomes a gift, because it helps us understand that actually we need to care for ourselves, or we need to engage something. Did you have any time during that where, or during, this feels like a dumb question, because I feel like it just, of course you did, but did you ever have time where you felt like you lost hope, or where you hope was dormant, you know? Are those the same things to you, to lose hope or to have a dormant hope? Or did you feel through this whole period of working through that, and you had anticipatory grief, you know, with,
yeah.
and then you had regular grief, and then, you know, you've been re-traumatized, and then, you know, I would imagine maybe even, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, but the, even just grieving over what this now current trauma is doing to my mothering or my time with my children. And, you know, so there's all those kind of layers. And through that process, have you had times where you've just gone, I don't have hope anymore, or I forgot what it feels like to hope, or was hope consistent for you through that?
No. I'd like to think of it as being dormant, and there were many seasons and years where it was. I think all of Florence's life, like, it just, there was this dormant hope, like it was there. It was alive, but it was sleeping. And that's sort of the nature of grief. And like you mentioned, anticipatory grief. Yeah, that is a ruthless thing. You know, it's not, I'm worried that she could die. It's, I'm worried when she's going to die. And watching her lose all of these, you know, all of her abilities and her strength. And so I still had hope, just hope that God was good, and that I mean, it was just such a joy to be her mother and to see her every day. And that is what kept the hope alive. It's like, she's here right now. All that matters is this day right here. And so that was, yeah, it was really alive. But I think it just, you know, I like to think of it as like a seed, and it just kept getting layered with more and more dirt, you know? So the seed of hope was there, waiting for this rebirth, but just, I didn't necessarily see it coming, but just layer after layer of dirt kept getting packed on top of it. So by the time